Welcome to the Warren Lecture Series, and today is special in that it's dedicated to the Vardalakis Lecture. So there will be a brief ceremony after the presentation where I'll say a few words about Yanis, our former colleague, and give the Vardalakis Award to Professor DeBoorst. So it is indeed an honor for me to introduce today's speaker, Professor René DeBoorst, who is currently the Regius Chair of Civil Engineering and Mechanics at the University of Glasgow in the UK. This is a quite prestigious position, as it is, in fact, not endowed, but it is given by the Queen. Professor DeBoorst is a civil engineer by training, having received his PhD from Delft University in civil engineering. And of course, he established an outstanding interdisciplinary career across aerospace engineering, mechanical engineering, and of course, structural and geomechanics. He has held a number of positions in academia, being a distinguished professor at Delft, and also Eindhoven, where he also served as dean. His industry projects have included simulation and analysis of a number of very large projects, including dams in southwest Netherlands. Professor DeBoorst has authored over 13 books and 200 peer-reviewed articles, with seminal contributions in another number of areas, specifically damage and fracture in rock, concrete, and composites. He's currently editor-in-chief of two international journals, as well as the editor of the Encyclopedia of Computational Mechanics. He is fellow of the International Association for Computational Mechanics, a member of the Royal Netherlands Academy of Arts and Sciences, a fellow of the Royal Society of Edinburgh, and an officer in the Order of the National Merit in France. He has received a number of awards, and I'll just mention two of those, the Max Planck Research Award and the Computational Mechanics Award from IACM. So with that, I'm pleased to welcome, and please join me in welcoming René.
Thank you very much, Joe, for this very kind introduction. Today will be a rather broad lecture about multiscale mechanics and evolving discontinuities. And the examples and the work I will show you has by far not done by me alone. I would like to acknowledge especially my present and former students and postdocs, Pascal Aubertin, Faisal Irzal, Stefan Mai, Joris Hermans, Julien Vitoré, Clemens van Heusel, and Julien Finiele. Also, the discussions and the work together with Tom Huge and Alan Needleman, I would like to acknowledge. Well, before really going to the content, I would like to share a small anecdote with you. And we go back 25 years in time, to December 1989. We move to another continent, we move to Australia, and we go to Canberra. Well, December, it's quite nice weather in Canberra, quite warm. There was a nice workshop, I think organized by Bruce Hobbs and Alison Ord, and I believe it was something about bifurcation and localization or something like this. At some point, that was such of these small kind, nice workshops with limited attendance and lots of free time to discuss and to do things socially. So at some point, four people decided to go for a swim. And in alphabetical order, the names are Elias Ifontis, René DeBoorst, Hans Mulhouse, and Johannes Vardalakis. So we arrived at the swimming pool, and so we went into swimming gear. And this is an important detail. there were no lockers, so we just put our clothes in baskets. So we went for a swim, and many of you know that Johannes was a frequent swimmer. He swam, I think, every morning or something like this. So he proposed at some point to have a race. 1 kilometer race. So we joined him. You can imagine sort of what happened. After 100 meters, well, was it 100 meters? Probably less. Elias Ifontis gave up. A little bit later, 100 meters further, Hans Mulhuis thought, okay, this is enough for today. Johannes and I made it to the end. And I was happy. I thought, okay, I knew that Johannes was well trained, but I was leading almost the whole way until the sort of the very last 50 or 100 meters when Johannes sort of put a little sprint and overtook me and won. So that's so far so good. But then we went to dress again, and that all went well, except for the fact that Johannes couldn't find his shoes. So he said, "Where are my shoes?" And then he got a brainwave, and he thought, okay, this guy René, who I bet during the swimming wants to take revenge, he put my shoes away. So he, at some point he said, came to me, he said, "René, you stole my shoes, where are my shoes?" So whenever I met him after that, he came to me, "René, where are my shoes?" So, now about the matter. Multiscale problems are all around. One of the most famous, in my mind, multiscale problems is the San Andreas Fault. It's hundreds and hundreds of kilometers long, and actually when you know where the actual problems occur, the actual shearing zone is just a few millimeters, maybe a centimeter wide. To model that in any numerical scheme would be impossible without going to multiscale techniques. Another problem, man-made, is the A380. We're talking about something like more than 70 meters long, a span of 70 meters, so I took this from my aerospace time. And the upper fuselage is made of a material which is called glare. Glare is made of alternating layers of aluminium and glass fiber reinforced epoxy. Now, this is 70 meters or something. When you see here, this is a SEM microscope, and you see it is about 1.3 millimeters that this skin is thick. So we are talking here, when you look into these typical failures, here a delamination, or here a matrix crack, they are just 0.1, 0.2 millimeters. And when you zoom in further with your SEM, you see that's not a delamination here, that's actually a crack that occurs here in the within the epoxy between the fiber low and the fiber rich zone. So to model this in one go is just impossible. You have to go to more sophisticated techniques. So essentially what we have here the macroscopic problem, the fuselage. Problems occur at the millimeter level or the submillimeter level, and we go down in fact to microscopic level and nanoscopic levels. But it's not only occurring in solids, it's also occurring in fluids. For instance, I've worked a bit on fluid structure interaction, again in the time I was at aerospace, and here you have a wing, and here you see the turbulence behind the wing, and when you want to go to the scale of really bad UFT turbulent vortex dynamics, you go to millimeters, and when you go further cascading down to where you have the energy dissipation, you're going to the scale of micrometers. And again, it's impossible to model this in these large-scale simulations. But you've also problems there which not relate to the scales, but to the times. Typical problems we have to face now, for instance in biomechanics, but also in many problems in geomechanics, are that you have multiple diffusion problems. For instance, a diffusion relation for the water. Here we have the relative fluid velocity, the porosity. Here we have the gradient of the pressure. And here we have the coefficients for the permeability. But you can also have some diffusion of ions. And here we have again a coefficient. Here we have the relative velocity of the ions with respect to the fluid. And here we have the potential for the gradient of the potential for that. And again, of course, coefficients. Not so difficult, it seems, except for the fact that the coefficients here are several orders of magnitude different from the coefficients here. And therefore, the time steps you would need to take if you would take a straightforward simulation are, again, several orders of magnitude different. Now, as I see it, there are basically two ways to multiscale problems. One is upscaling. Examples are there. Numerical homogenization, I'll come to that. Or, for instance, in fluids, where you have Reynolds average Navier-Stokes. Essentially, this means that here, the Navier-Stokes equations, you average in a small region orthogonal to the beam. When you talk about concurrent computing, well, the simplest way, or one simple example, is just HP adaptivity. But you can also think of multigrid methods, variational multiscale methods, and so on. Now, let's first talk a bit about upscaling methods. Well, the idea of upscaling methods is that we try to devise relations at a low scale, for instance, between atoms, ambitious, that we then try to derive models at the micro level, for instance, for dislocation movement. Then we go to a meso level, polycrystals, and finally we arrive at constitutive relations at a macroscopic continuum mechanics level. In all these approaches, the concept of a representative volume element is crucial. Essentially here, we have an example of that. It's a unidirectional composite, so we have a matrix with unidirectional fibers. And we try to find something that is repetitive. Well, this square is, for instance, repetitive. And a typical simulation would then be that you take this out, that you apply periodic boundary conditions, and then try to derive homogenized properties at the level of this entire ply, and then you go up and up. Now, this works well for elasticity problems. You can even do it for time-dependent problems. But to failure, you usually run into problems. The problem is, with failure, you break the periodicity. And then it's almost impossible, when you do it traditionally, to define a representative volume element. At the moment, there are approaches to get around that, but just straightforward application of that does not give you any good results. Now, the other approach is concurrent multiscale. Essentially, it's simple. You have a nonlinear problem, an operator A, a right-hand B. You cast it in a variational format, and then you have a multiscale decomposition. You just say, okay, my unknown U is additively composed of something that varies slowly at the core scale, plus something that varies more quickly, more rapidly, which is the fine scale. And you plug this additive decomposition into your variational form, and you obtain something like this. Now, the whole idea behind the whole idea between a variety of all these multiscale methods is that you approximate these cross terms by a simple approximate relation. So essentially what you do is you approximate this term and you bring it to the right-hand side, and then you solve for the core scale just by solving this and this as a modifier to right-hand side. The trick is to do to approximate this one in a smart way. And for that, there's a variety of methods available. Possibilities are substructuring, Lagrangian multipliers, residual free bubbles, Green's functions. There's a whole range, and you get all sorts of fancy names in the literature. Don't be confused by that. Essentially, it is just boils down to how do I approximate the coupling term. Now, it becomes a bit more difficult when you try to couple dissimilar equations. When you try to couple, for instance, continuum mechanics to molecular dynamics. In certain branches of science, molecular dynamics has become quite fashionable, I would almost say. But as structural engineers, we know that we will never be able to calculate an entire structure using molecular dynamics. So the best one can do then is to model the entire structure using continuum mechanics and a small region where molecular dynamics or something else can be useful, you do that there. But then you face the problem that you have to couple continuum mechanics to an atomistic type approach. And this is a problem because usually in our continuum mechanics we have local continuum. Not necessarily, but usually we have it. While in molecular dynamics we always have non-local constitutive relations. Potentials are non-local relations. So we have here to couple a local constitutive relation to a non-local constitutive relation. Now the best way to do that is a so-called zonal coupling. Well, essentially you have two options again. You easily say, okay, we have a sharp interface, or you say, okay, I do this coupling over a finite zone. And my experience is that this zonal coupling, this overlap coupling, is the best option, especially when you go to dynamics. The idea is we just have a weighting function, alpha, another weighting function, beta, and here we have an overlap domain, a coupling domain, where both the continuum mechanics and your molecular dynamics is valid. You weight them such that alpha plus beta is always 1. And then you make it such that you have the energy which is distributed, the energy in the overlap zone always is constant there, and as a consequence of that, because you keep the energy constant, you not necessarily keep the displacements the same. You have a weak coupling of the displacements and therefore the velocities as a consequence of this energy enforcement. Now, these are some examples what you can do then. Here we have a continuum domain, here we have a molecular dynamics domain, and here we again have a continuum domain. And here you see small areas where you have the overlap coupling. Well, first an example, what happens if you don't do it properly? Here you see a spurious reflection of a wave. If you do everything properly, you see that the wave simply goes through. Now, this was a toy problem. This is a somewhat more serious problem, where we have a two-dimensional case. Here we have a domain. Here we have a starter notch, and we try to simulate fracture propagation in molecular dynamics. Now, here we have our continuum mechanics, just elasticity. Here, the pear-shaped region is molecular dynamics, and here, these parts are just overlap parts where we have both the continuum mechanics and the molecular dynamics. In the wake, we have a friction-free crack because we used an extended finite element method in the wake of the crack tip. Here are the results of that for different loading rates. And I don't claim that these results are quantitatively okay. It's just a qualitative simulation. The quantitative problem only comes from the fact that it is very difficult to determine potentials that are truly reflecting material behavior. This is one of the things which I find sometimes a little bit almost irritating, and people who go to molecular dynamics, they claim it's more physics in there. Fine, but it's still, these potentials are still constitutive relations, and there's still some assumption in it. We would have to go at least one level deeper into quantum mechanics in order to really get more physics in there. Now, the results are, from a qualitative point, interesting. This is for a low loading weight. Here you see that for a higher loading weight, you get already a little bit more tortuosity and some shearing here. It gets stronger here, even stronger here, and for high loading weights, you get really the branching which you see experimentally. Now, we go to the continuum level. And here I would like to make a statement, because what you see when people model damage and fracture is that there are sort of two schools. There is the continuum school and there is the discrete school. People who say, okay, a fracture is discrete, and therefore you have to treat it discretely. There are other people who say, well, sometimes there's so much things going on in such a zone, it's rather a continuous description of something, of some degradation phenomenon. I don't want to take sides in that. I just want to be pragmatic. At some point, it is more pragmatic to treat a discontinuity as a discontinuity, and sometimes it's more pragmatic to treat it as a continuity. The approach I usually take, and I think that's quite reasonable for many of the materials I've worked on, composites, concrete, many rocks, is the cohesive approach to fracture, essentially where you have a finer zone ahead of the crack tip, where you have breakage, microcracking, plasticity, and so on. So here we have our fully open crack, here we have our closed continuum, and here we have our transition zone. Essentially, we here have a discrete traction separation law. Essentially, the cohesive concept is a discrete concept with simple parameters, just a tensile strength, a fracture energy, and the shape of the decohesion curve. Now, about the latter one, there is some debate. Some people say this shape is very important. Other people say it's not important at all. Truth is that when you go to more ductile materials, it's not important. When you go to more brittle materials, it can be highly important and is sometimes more important, or quite often more important than the precise value of the tensile strength. The basic thing is, of all these relations, is that you arrive at a discrete traction separation relation where your traction is derived by differentiating a fracture energy function with respect to the crack opening. And of course, you can also do that the same thing for shearing relations. Now, I emphasized that these cohesive surface models are two-dimensional models. They are discrete models, two-dimensional models in a three-dimensional continuum. So that means that we are sort of losing some information. Because we only have crack opening, crack sliding, and the corresponding tractions, but we don't have the in-plane strains and the in-plane stresses. As a consequence of that, a typical phenomenon like stress triaxiality is not incorporated in any cohesive surface model. Examples are, for instance, crashing in polymers, but also when you look into splitting cracks in shear critical concrete beams, you would have not all the information to do that properly. So the solution we have worked on is, well, let's replace this purely zero thickness cohesive surface model by a thin layer cohesive bend model with a small thickness H, where the condition is that this thickness is much smaller than any structural length or the length of the crack. So what we do now is we define subgrade strains, epsilon NN, epsilon NS, and epsilon NT, which are just displacements divided by some relevant opening size there. And this is standard, And then additionally, we say, okay, since the crack opening is small to the other dimensions, the strain here, the parallel strain here, is not varying so much over the width of the crack. So we can approximate quite well epsilon SS, so the strain along the crack, by the average of that at one side plus the average at the other side. And same for the other strains, epsilon TT and epsilon ST. The question is, of course, so the advantage is that you get a fully three-dimensional stress-strain relation. For instance, when you have a two-dimensional case, you have the normal relation, which means that you have the Young's modulus and also the stiffness orthogonal to the crack, which degrades it. Same for your degrading shear stiffness, but you have now also a coupling parameter, a sort of Poisson ratio within the bend. And this coupling parameter enables you to quantify or to model the triaxiality effect. Before going to an example, I want to show you that, and that's always a requirement, if you make something extra, does it collapse to the thing we know without these effects? And it does. So our internal work, virtual work, is this expression. When we substitute the strains as we have defined them before, we arrive at this. And we here keep H, the width of the band, here and here for the additional strains. So when we let this collapse to zero, H goes to zero, then we arrive at a familiar expression for your cohesive surface model. Now, this is an example of that. Here we have a double cantilever beam. Here we have an initial notch. We have some forces here. And when you have the traditional cohesive surface model, you end up with these round circles. When you put this in-bend Poisson ratio equal to zero, you reproduce this result exactly. This is what we wanted to have. But when you increase this, you get a more stronger and a more ductile effect. So this is just a sort of proof of concept. We are working still on more examples and extensions to large strains. Now, the next issue is, we have modeled that, how do we actually capture a discontinuity? Well, when we want to do it in a discrete sense, there's a host of methods available: conventional interface elements, mesh-free methods, discontinuous Kolurkin methods, especially popular in fluid mechanics, and the partition of unity-based methods and isogeometric analysis, which I think are the most promising at the moment. A brief recap: partition of unity ideas or extended finite element methods. We here have the standard polynomials. We have our standard parameters here, and we just enrich it by additional functions contained in this psi here. In a conventional finite element notation, your displacement then becomes your matrix with the traditional polynomials times your vector with the unknowns plus an additional term now. And if you assume that the enhanced field is a discontinuity which is centered at the crack, then you obtain that psi, this capital matrix psi, is a Heaviside function times the identity. Substituting that in here, we obtain an additive decomposition of your displacement into this term plus this term separated by a Heaviside function. So you can see that in a sense again as a sort of coarse scale, fine scale decomposition, although slightly in a different sense. Now, this is an example of such a calculation. Here we have a ramp loading on the top and the bottom. We have an initial notch here, and here we have an interface because materials 1 and 2 are not the same. So here we have a sort of glue layer. And when you start simulating them, this, you get something like this. Here you have the crack, and then you here have a daughter crack, and then this is arrested, and then it propagates again along the interface. Now, this seems a beautiful result, unless we started, and it is nice, but then we started to play a little bit around with other meshes, and we found that for some meshes, the daughter crack propagates, and for others, not, like here. And this has to do with the fact, and that's a problem which you cannot cure, that the stress resolution around crack tips of finite elements is not so good. When you shift integration points a little bit as a consequence of another mesh, then you can easily end up with very different stresses which give different propagation directions. So this is one of the crucial problems which we still have there. You can apply this technique to many other things. For instance, here is an example of application to twinning of martensite, where you don't have a strong discontinuity, but where you have a discontinuity in the gradient, and then you don't use a Heaviside function, but you use a sine distance function. Something like this, you have a linear function to here, and again to here. And what you then do is you can trace your weak discontinuity using level sets. A simple example of that would be something like this. Here we have a plate with two different moduli, Young's modulus E1 and E2. And normally you always put the discontinuity coinciding with Enderman boundaries, but this technique in principle allows you to do it arbitrarily. Now this is a toy problem again. More interesting problem is the simulation of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, which is often used to describe propagating fronts. Here you have the scalar, here you have the propagation speed, and here you have the gradient of scalar. You can cast that in a weak format, and you can solve that. Most solutions are using finite differences. You can solve it also using finite elements, but then you have to exploit again this partition of unity property, and you get something like this. This is an example where we have two evolving spheres, and you see how it further evolves. If you have this is for linear interpolation, this is for quadratic interpolation, and here you see that upon mesh refinement you get much smoother results as you would expect. Now, a more interesting case, and coming more closer to the field Yannis Vardalakis has worked on, saturated porous media. When you extend it to saturated porous media, you again have this decomposition of the displacement into two displacements, but you should do something different for the pressures. In fact, for the pressures, you should use this decomposition using a sine distance function. Because when you do that, you obtain that the gradient is separated by the Heaviside function, which means that at the crack, you have a discontinuity in the pressure gradient. And this is exactly what you want, because a discontinuity in the pressure gradient implies a discontinuity in the relative fluid velocity. And this allows you, if you have a discontinuity in the relative fluid velocity, to have that the normal fluid velocity here is different from that here, and the difference can be going in storage in the crack or in transport of fluid in the crack, which is exactly what you would like to have. Then you're not yet ready, because you have to go into the micro level to derive homogenized equations at this level for upscaling to couple them to the macroscopic level. So what we do is we just set up the mass balance in the cavity. We integrate that. We neglect for the time being this term, and we obtain the jump in the velocity, the relative velocity from here to here, as the integral from here to here over dv dx integrated along y. Well, it takes a little bit of algebra. I will not go into all of that, but you have to invoke the continuity at the cavity boundaries. So I assume that the fluid, relative fluid velocity, just inside the bulk is exactly the same as just in a crack. So a sort of non-slip boundary condition. And I also exploit the balance of momentum for Newtonian fluid. Now, when you elaborate that a little bit, you get a somewhat nasty term, a coupling term for the mass balance at the microscopic level in the crack and the macroscopic level at your porous medium. Because here you have your porosity of your medium, here you have your relative fluid velocity orthogonal to the crack, and this is equal to, well, something that is proportional to the power 3 of the width of the crack. It is, here we have a second gradient of the pressure, and here there are some other terms. So we see that even if we have a linear solid, we have already non-linearity. We need a higher order interpolation for the pressure in the fluid, and because this term occurs in the mass balance equation and not in the momentum balance equation, we also have a non-symmetric system of equations. Fortunately, it's weakly non-symmetric, and you can very well solve it with a symmetric solver. Some examples. First example exploits linear elastic fracture mechanics, and we have stationary cracks. So here we have fluid flowing in. Here we have an impervious boundary, here also, and here we have a zero pressure. Here we have the locations of the cracks predefined, here, here, and here, and here. And this is on a regular mesh. So it is a regular 40 by 40 mesh composed of crossed quadratic triangles, so which is not that much. But clearly, these cracks are not aligned with any element boundaries. So it's a subgrid scale model. What you clearly see is that at the ends, we have strong pressure gradients, and also that, for instance, this crack is clearly shielded by this larger crack. We've also run these things for biaxial tests, where here we have not a linear elastic fracture mechanics criterion, but just a more Coulomb criterion for sliding. So what you see here is that, so there's a displacement applied here, and then you have here the evolution of the displacement field, a very nice shear bend, which evolves. Well, we can also look at the pressure, what happens to the water pressure. And this is what is happening here. These are dynamic simulations, so you see the wave propagating. Now, when we increase the ductility along the interface, we get an interesting result. You see that at some point the shear bend evolves, arrests, and then will initiate somewhere else. So I show this again. When you increase the adhesion, then you get it's arrested and it starts there again. Now we have extended this recently also to cohesive crack propagation, to large deformations, and these are some results for the fluid pressure, for the norm of the relative fluid velocity. I would now to go a little bit to talk about isodynamic analysis. One of the sort of, I would almost say, fashionable topics in computational mechanics nowadays. The concept is quite simple. We just replace our Lagrangian basis functions by NURBS or spline basis functions. For linears, it's the same. For quadratics, you get different results. Here you see the traditional Lagrangian polynomials, and the red and the dark blue and the green are the splines. One of the driving forces is that it is possible to have an exact representation of the geometry, and another advantage is that these spline functions are normally used in CAD packages, so in principle it is very easy to transfer those things to finite element or to analysis without additional meshing. I think that one of the other big advantages is that the stresses are much more accurately calculated. And for me that is even a bigger advantage, because for an engineer displacements are interesting, but the stresses are more interesting. For instance, problems like I showed with this daughter crack, where the stresses around the crack tip are not well calculated, can be ameliorated with this kind of approaches. The other advantage is that the approach is quite flexible. You can, of course, enrich it. You can go from linears, for instance, to quadratics by order elevation, but you can also do a process like knot insertion, and this boils down to lowering the continuity. Now, this is interesting when you want to model cracks, because cracks are nothing but lowering the continuity. But first, this remark for improved stresses holds for any derived quantity. So, for instance, in poor mechanics, where the pressures are typically interpolated, but where the flow is the important thing, in finite element analysis you would get, for this simple one-dimensional case, this solution for your relative fluid velocity. And as a consequence, there's always the issue of local mass preservation. When you have a continuous function, you have therefore also a continuous derivative. When you have sufficient higher continuity of your primary interpolate, you also have continuity of your derived function. And that's when you get something like this. And as a consequence, mass balance, local mass balance, is ensured. Now, I said another advantage, in addition to the derived quantities, is that you can do knot insertion, which is equal to lowering the continuity. So you not only can go up to C1 or C2 or whatever continuity, you can also go to C-1 continuity, which is essentially a crack. Here we did it for a simple case of a fiber embedded in a matrix, and here you see the crack evolving. Here you see some solutions with a coarse mesh here and with two finer meshes here. This is a somewhat more challenging example. We have here a cantilever beam, double cantilever beam, again with a glue layer here and with a small notch here. And what you see then, we get a crack that propagates in a curved fashion to the glue layer and then starts propagating along the glue layer. And again, the first coarse mesh is still a bit bumpy, but then you get a very smooth converged solution. Now, so far so good about discrete concepts. Another way of capturing cracks is that you smear it. And of course there's the engineering approach and the scientific approach. The engineering approach is that you say, okay, I let the discretization, your finite element discretization, take care of this. And then you get the so-called, all these mesh-dependent solutions. In an engineering sense, fine, for instance, using these called, so-called crack-bent approaches. However, the better way is to properly regularize your ill-post equations. And there's a host of strategies to do that. Coursera theories, like Johannes worked on rate-dependent models, like Alan Edelman, for instance, worked on non-local theories. Stedelijk Bazant worked on that. I think that from a practical computational point of view, the gradient theories are more sort of efficient. And recently we have seen a surge of so-called phase field theories, motivated by their popularity in physics. People in engineering have taken over those. I will show you that gradient theories and phase field theories are quite closely related, more so than sometimes is suggested. But I will start with that the very fact that you introduce higher order gradients makes, again, isogeometric analysis a really powerful tool, because the problem is often when you go to higher order gradients that you need more continuity. And this is sometimes difficulty with standard finite elements. Now let me very quickly go to the problem I use here, damage mechanics, standard damage mechanics. The non-local regularization would be something like this. A gradient approximation would be something like this. And here you recognize the emergence of the higher order gradients, which would require c to the power half p minus 1 continuous interpolations. Normally, you don't have this in standard finite elements. This is an example of an analysis using isogeometric finite elements for a fourth order gradient problem, which requires C1 continuity. Here you see that it quickly converges to a solution. Here you see the damage profiles for a moderate stage and for an advanced stage. And you see also the problem which damage mechanics approaches always have, namely that the damage not only propagates in the direction of the crack, but also orthogonal to that. You get the broadening here. Now, how does this come? When you look into gradient approaches, when you look into phase field approaches, you see that some simulations, and I took here an example of Mike Borden, doesn't give that. The crack remains quite constant. If you would have to do that using a damage model, you would have to adapt the internal length scale in such a damage model depending on the damage evolution. And apparently phase field formulations do that automatically, and let's see why. Look at the free energy function, which is used typically in these phase field formulations. You have this one, and typically there's a function G which is governing that. Now, in a second order gradient damage model, you can identify that you use also a G which is equal to 1 minus D. When you use phase field formulations, there are different functions, but the simplest functions already have 1 minus d squared. This means that when you look at a driving force, that in this case, f becomes a constant function, and here it is a constant function times 1 minus d. So for fully evolved damage, d equals 1, this is not driving anymore, while this continues to drive and gives this broadening. But I think that phase field approaches are oversold. They have been introduced as a purely mathematical concept. And when you look into the parameters you need to make it work in fracture, you have to introduce again an internal length scale and the degradation function. And these are not purely mathematical parameters. These are parameters with a physical meaning. And here, for instance, when you have a variation of the internal length scale, you get very different results. Logical. If here you have a variation of your G function, you get also very different results. This is, the red one is for a quadratic function, which I showed. This one is for a cubic function. So depending on the material parameters, and I call them material parameters, which you use in phase field models, you get very, very different results, which is usually not shown, unfortunately. Recently, we have worked on the extension of phase fit models to cohesive fracture, because all models published so far are for purely brittle fracture. Essentially, it's relatively simple, essentially, because you have an internal energy, which is your Helmholtz free energy for your elastic part, plus your fracture energy. And the only difference is that your fracture energy is not a constant anymore, but is depending on your crack opening. And like in standard phase fit models, you approximate your Dirac function for your discontinuity in the strain by a regularized thing, which is distributed over finite length. And when you introduce that in here, you obtain something like this. Now, this looks pretty similar, but notice that here we have replaced the crack opening by a field V. And this field V is continuous because we are smearing it, while the crack opening is only existing at a discrete point at the crack. And we need something which is now a continuum approach. To make that work, you have to enforce that the crack opening is constant orthogonal to the crack. So here we have the additional auxiliary requirement dv dxn x equal to 0, and you have to add this to the internal energy functional, and you get this augmented functional, where here you have a sort of penalty term. So when you elaborate that, you get here an internal boundary condition, which is the stress times the normal at the boundary equals your traction plus this term. Well, does it work? Well, I'll first give you the positive message and then I'll give you the negative message. Again, a simple cantilever peel test. Here we have a notch. We have some forces here. Here you see the load displacement curves for different levels of mesh refinement. Here you see the phase field evolving, propagating into the beam here. And here you see the stresses evolving. So this looks quite okay. Now, the problem we have here is that we have a three-field problem. We have displacements, we have the auxiliary field, V, and we have also the phase field. It's always important when you have a three-field problem to be careful with the order of interpolation of each field. So if you take them all the same order, you get these kind of beautiful stress oscillations to be expected, but you get them. And if you become a bit smarter, when you sort of realize that you have to take some a bit higher order than others, you can get perfect results without stress oscillations. So we were happy then, until we went to two dimensions. So we carried out a patch test for the same one-dimensional bar, but now in two dimensions. And we took a completely regular mesh one time. So here we have the stress applied, here applied, and a slight disturbance of the mesh in the other case. We should get a homogeneous stress again, but we don't get it. Here you see that you get fully homogeneous stress. Here you see that you don't get it. So this is where we are stuck at the moment. We are still thinking of the brainwave. So this is really the point where we have arrived at the moment. So in sum, phase field approaches have been pursued quite a bit as sort of the holy grail for smeared approaches to fracture. I would sort of damp this optimism a little bit. They can be useful, but their extension to cohesive fracture is non-trivial, and also for brittle fracture, there are a number of parameters there which are sort of physical and which can influence results quite a bit. So in sum, important issues in current computational mechanics are multiscale and multiphysics concepts. My opinion is when you go to model fracture and damage, it's a matter of philosophy, of pragmatism, whether you go the discrete way or the smeared way, and it is quite often problem dependent. For instance, when you look into problems like fractures in fluid saturated media, if you want to describe the fluid flow properly, there's probably no other way than to go in a discrete way. And finally, in the end, whichever model we have to discretize it. And it seems at the moment that partition of unity-based finite element methods, isogematic elements are flexible tools, but there are some problems to be overcome. Current approaches, for instance, in isogematics are very much based on NURBS or when you have local refinement T-splines. But in our experience, that is not good enough. You need a bit more than that in order to properly model cracks in arbitrary directions. So, thank you very much.
We have time for a few questions, and I have to bring the microphone to you, so if there are any questions or comments.
Conceptually, I don't see a difference between isoparametric and isogeometric other than different approximating functions. Is there a difference that you see or not?
You're totally right. In principle, you just use other interpolation functions which have, by nature, higher order continuity.
So the only difference is that this isogeometric stuff, the different function splines were used in geometric design, right, Dyson?
Yes. But it has some consequences.
Thank you for a very nice lecture. I just have a couple of questions. One of them is you showed those results of simulation for shear bands, no? Mm-hmm. Dynamic calculations.
Yes.
You mentioned plasticity more Coulomb. Clearly, we see a band, a fracture propagating. Do you do anything at the tip of this band? Is there any special treatment there?
It's just a pure sort of shear type relation. I just use a more Coulomb interface relation to initiate the bend and to propagate it. And I use an energy criterion. I use a more Coulomb criterion to initiate it, and I use an energy criterion to propagate it. So it's just a sort of shear equivalent of a cohesive model. And therefore, I don't have to do anything special at the tip.
But is there any softening associated with that? Is there any energy?
Yes, you dissipate energy.
But is it finite in a sense? It's like a shear crack. That's what I'm asking.
Yes. Yes, it's finite.
It's a non-linear fracture.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. In that sense, yes.
Any other questions?
Thank you also from my side for a very nice lecture. Probably due to my age, I still have this graduate student related attitude to look at these models, and I always ask myself, what do I have to do to bring it into my file? Into my finite element code. So in this sense, I have one question for this coherent phase field model that you showed at the end of your lecture. So I wouldn't have so much a problem with these oscillations that you showed. I can just increase the polynomial degree and then they can mitigate it a bit. But I have a problem with this condition that you stated, this V over a geometric direction, so along the track. That I would think I would think this is very difficult to implement because you have to do geometry related operations that need to know the direction of your crack. So my question is, how do you do that? This one, V over dx. How do you do that?
There you have to redo some geometry and for.
How do you track the direction of your crack?
You can do that locally.
So you have to find
yes.
find kind of you,
Yes. Yes.
So you have to find that.
Yes.
Okay. So,
yes.
So here you're basically losing one of the advantages that face fields actually.
Indeed.
Okay. But there's no trick to.
No. But I mean it's a little bit bookkeeping. It's a bit nasty. But in our finding, that was not the biggest thing that caused us headaches.
Okay.
Real quick. Okay. So when you compare the face field model with the gradient model, if I want these two models to have the same result, what's the difference in the length scale in these two models?
Oh, that's an interesting question. I've not looked at that. Well, one of the there's no straight answer to that, because if you compare them, and I've not shown that on these slides, it when you see is that the length scale in a gradient damage model, when you would take the phase field model and try to cast it in the same sort of format, then the result is that the phase field model has a varying length scale. Mm-hmm. And this is also responsible for the fact that the crack in the wake of the tip does not broaden. Essentially, you decrease the length scale there. That is what comes, what is the consequence of how the phase field model is constructed.
Okay, I mentioned that this seminar today is special in the sense that it is the Vardalakis lecture. I'd like to say a few words about Yanis, a former faculty member in this department from 1980 to 1990. Yanis started as an assistant professor and rose to the ranks. He left the University of Minnesota and went to the National Technical University of Athens in Greece. But he stayed in close contact and tragically passed away in 2009. This is the fifth Vardalakis lecture. And I should have mentioned that Renee is also here as the MTS visiting professor. And he will be here next week as well. So some of this discussion can't continue. He'll be here until November 6th. So with that, I'd like to award Professor DeVorst with the Vardalakis lecture. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jim.
We do have a reception outside, and please join us. Thank you.
Yeah, Mr. And I could send this to you if you don't want to.
I think I can
send it.
Yeah. I can.